Hey everyone, I'm Bungie, aka Benjamin Arnaud, or the other way around, not sure about that. Thank you very much for joining us today. This is Motionbox, the video browser, and I'm coding it live. I can't believe I'm here today. I had a very busy week and a very tiring week. I'm very tired. Lots of things going right and wrong these days. So, you know, it will be a very special stream because I didn't code Motionbox since the last stream, so I believe, not much. And so hopefully we can make some progress today. Let's start right away. So today is episode 7. And the date is June 16, 2016. All right. Is my Chromium browser still working? Yes, it is. That's good news. So don't hesitate if you have any question, shoot them in the chat. I'll be more than happy to answer them since it's quite manageable for me. Let's review something. This is the Omega website. This is the Motionbox page where you can get it. Don't hesitate to do so and give me feedback if you want. Here's the forum there, and if we click there, we can see I've edited a bunch of things on these pages. Now, first of all, here's Torrent Streaming. So we're now on episode 6. This is the chapter 1 called Torrent Streaming, and there's a bunch of information there. First of all, you can click on Motionbox to get more information. You can get it. There's a bunch of information there, so don't hesitate to go there. And as we progress, I'll add more and more links so that... is my sound good? Oh, yeah, okay. As we progress, there'll be more and more links there. So don't hesitate to check by. And here, I've added a new page, which is called Highlights. And what this is basically the highlights of the long stream that I do. Because I'm aware that most people, are not very familiar with coding. So maybe what they want is just, you know, short videos that they can watch when they have the time. And I currently, you know, processed 5 videos. And for instance, you know, we could play this one. You know, and it's a very quick video.
You're browsing for it. And when you find it, you play it. And all of a sudden, you've stepped into a whole...
So it basically, slices the best highlights, or at least the most interesting one that I do during my stream. So you can check them here if you want. Also, don't forget that everything is on GitHub, the whole history of what we code, and of course, the code for SkyKit and Motionbox is available too. Let's proceed. So, let's go. So if I remember well, previous time we did a bunch of things. We created the torrent engine. We created an abstract hook, because I've explained that instead of re-implementing a whole new backend, I thought it would be more interesting to actually have a hook that could, you know, interrupt or intercept, if you will, a few function call so that it could do the things related to torrent before calling the native backend, the native playback backend, if you will. So what I want to do today, actually, I don't know what I want to do today. That's the fun part. I'm not sure about what's next, but you know, I'm probably going to implement Torrent Engine a little bit more. Let me see. There, yeah. So what would So what we've done here previously is we pretty much declared a thread and moved torrent, libtorrent to a thread. It's going to thread itself by itself. I believe, you know, libtorrent is using threads. But inside of MotionBox, I want it in its own thread because I think it's a cleaner implementation. And since I'm not sure about everything that it does, it's probably the best choice here. So here we can see that we're starting pretty much the libtorrent session. So we're creating it there. And now there should be a way to register for getting the messages from the library. So let's see if we can do that actually. The way libtorrent works is pretty much popping alerts. And, you know, I believe that we're supposed to... Oh, there's an alert cast. Okay. Okay, so here is pretty much doing an infinite loop, but we're not going to do it this way. If I remember well, we don't have to. So let's go to libtorrent manual, maybe, or something like that. Pop alerts, wait for alerts. Set alert dispatch. That's the one I'm interested by. Oh. Libtorrent GitHub. Go there. This. Really? Weird. What's that? It's weird. Cool. Okay. So yeah, I believe I'm supposed to give him a function there. The thing that I'm worried about is, can this be a method? May not call any of libtorrent external API function. Doing so result in a deadlock. Not so great, is it? Not what I want. Let's wait for alerts. So pop alerts is used to ask the session if an error has occurred. With set alert mask and filter which alert to receive. Pop alerts pops all pending alerts in a single call. In a high performance environment with a very high alert churn rate, this can save significant amount of time compared to popping alerts one at a time. Wait for alert blocks until an alert is available. I don't want that. main loop. Query the torrent handles for progress. Yeah. What I'm currently wondering about is, can I avoid using a loop like this? I would love to, because I would love to. So here, if I'm not mistaken, we're posting event to queue, and queue has been moved to thread. Yeah, so here we're actually in the thread here, okay. Let me review the BitTorrent example sample. I believe there are some that did not use the loop. I believe I found that last time, actually. So yeah. What's this? Oh. The client test, the big one. Action tester. C'est une vue simple client. Yeah, okay. So session there. Okay, so session. I believe that set alert dispatch is the one we need. Actually, you know what? Let's try something here. I believe I've actually did that previously. So if I go there. Let me check that, actually. Yeah, the previous episode, I think I did it. I think I found something related to that, if I remember well.
Python is up in 1 month. So I think if you really get to it, and if you really... It's not just a rename, it's a change. Are updated. Yeah. I'll commit it this way. I review anyway. I'm reviewing my commit. So if it doesn't feel right, I'll take of it.
Yeah. It's not. Okay, never mind. Never mind. We're going to use that most likely. I have to find it though, so I'm not sure why it didn't find it when I did that. Now it does. This is weird. Alright. Test transfer here. Satellite dispatch. There's one there. Session. Yeah. Implementation. Okay. So let's focus here. Set alert dispatch, my dear. Yeah, print alert. So that's the code I was reviewing before. That's this one. Yeah, okay. So here's what I'm going to do. So if I understand well what happens, here I'm getting it from the thread of LibTorrent. That's what they say here. So for instance, here, this sets a function to be called every time an alert is posted. Since the function is run in LibTorrent's internal thread, so yeah, like I said before, there's an internal thread in LibTorrent. It may not call any of LibTorrent's external API functions. Doing so results in a deadlock, which is pretty bad. Deadlocking is when, you know, two threads are locked because they're accessing the same resource at the same time. So what we have to do is when we're in the alert dispatch, when we're, you know, in the function pointer there, inside of this function, we have to say, okay, what is this alert about? Is this important? Yes, it's important. Well, if it's important and we have to call the LibTorrent API, we need to post an event and say, call this function, call that function or whatever. I think that's the best way to do it. And I think also it will be, if it's called from the LibTorrent thread, it's probably low level enough to be performant. So hopefully it will be fast enough. I'm going to do a small break, get a coffee and get things running on my side here, and then we can do that. Hey, I'm back. Alright. So, let's get to it. So here I'm creating a private function that is going to be called every time LibToN pops an alert, so you know, so we can process things. And this function is going to be in LibToN thread, so we have to pay attention to that. Set alert, there it is. Alert dispatch. So, wait a sec. What's alert notify? What? The F? The setAlertNotify function lets the client set a function object to be invoked every time the alert queue goes from having 0 alerts to 1 alert. So this is what I've, you know, I remember now, this is what I've reviewed last time. So I'm not sure why I did not found it this time, because it's no longer there. So, yeah, this is weird. It doesn't seem to appear in the documentation anymore. Is it because it has been removed? Yeah. Hold on. Deprecating? What's deprecating? Restore set alert function. Restore set alert dispatch function, but deprecated. Is it deprecated? This sets a function to be called every time an alert is posted. It may not block. Ah, okay. main intention with this function is to support integration with platform-dependent message queue. Alright. No, that's not what I want. I think that's what I want is not this. I think what I want is set alert. Notify. And I want it on process alert. Yeah. I'm not a big fan of my naming here. Okay. Let's call it this way for now, but you know, I'm not sure if. Okay. Will it build? No, it doesn't. Invalid use of the expression. Whoa. What the fuck? Alert notify. Not sure about this syntax here. Not sure about this syntax. So double scope. Set alert notify in member function. Someone is talking in the chat, Dakota Ryan 0123. I have no clue what you're doing. Well, neither do I. Currently quite lost in trying to implement the LibTorrent library to pretty much implement the torrent streaming in my player MotionBox. Trying to figure out how to process the alert. Okay, so set alert notify. If you have any question, by the way, don't hesitate, I can answer them. But for now, I really would like to understand this function here. So yeah, okay. How can I remove tab boost? Yeah, so I'm supposed to declare this, I guess. Type def boost function. Never used that before, so... In the next major release, this will be deprecated in favor of Settler Notify. Yeah. All I see is random words, dashes and other wavy lines, but you do your own thing. I don't know if you've seen the movie The Matrix, probably you've seen it. At one point there's like Neo who comes behind the operator or someone like that. And you know, he's watching The Matrix on his computer screen, and all we see as the audience is pretty much random numbers, you know, scrolling down. Well, when you code, it's pretty much the same. When I look at my code, and my code is pretty clean, to be honest. I don't really see text, I see the algorithm behind it, I see what it tries to do. So, you know, maybe if you learn it, and you can learn it pretty fast, like I was saying in the previous stream, you can get to understand what's happening there. Now, my intention with that stream is to be as authentic as possible, so if I'm struggling for something, then, you know, so be it. Even experienced programmer, they struggle, so I think that's interesting to see the highlights of what you're doing, and they happen randomly when you're coding, and also to see the downside of being a programmer, which is sometimes it's a struggle. So, yeah. LibTorrent set alert notify. I have no idea how to use that. That's a problem. Boost bind. Okay. I'm not sure how to declare a boost function. Never used that before. Okay. Boost function. This was the first parameter passed to the function. Really? That works this way? Seriously? Oh, Jesus. It's so ugly, man. Wow. Okay, that's the syntax I saw, actually. Yeah, that's this. Okay. What the f- Okay, needless to say, I'm not a big fan of that syntax. Yeah, it's pretty much, if I understand well, it's pretty much implementing inside of the parenthesis there. And here, if we look, you know, I never used something like that before, to be honest, or I don't remember. So, you know, boost users are going to think I'm a big noob there, but never mind. I don't care. So yeah. Okay, so you can retrieve the session there. What the man? Okay. So yeah, he is implementing the function right away inside of that. And it's working on all. No problem. And so what's IO service here? I'm not sure about that. Input output most likely. Yeah. Okay. This is cool. Okay. Can we call a Qdebug here? Hey. Looks like this syntax is not his cup of tea here. Yeah. It's probably something like that. Maybe there's a way to do it cleaner though. There's got a way to do it cleaner, man. Okay, but whoa. Okay. I was not declaring in that scope. Why do I give a parameter there? So this should do it. Process alert. Oops. This should do the trick. Hold on. Yeah. Wow. D is not captured. Okay. Can I do that? No matching function. Yeah. Okay. Why would this work? Yeah. So something is not working here. I'm not sure why. So hold on. Why cannot I do like they do? Is it because I'm using C++? No. So session. Okay, disable Okay, they're disabling it this way. Yeah, sure. Why not? Why cannot I use that? No matching function to call data.notify with the lambda here. Oh. It's not happy because we're inside the methods, maybe? Oh yeah, yeah. Not happy because of that. Wow. Intervals. Print alerts, yeah. Not sure about that. Okay. He's calling a function there. Yeah, okay, and the function then calls something. Okay. This one. Just trying things here. We'll see. All right. So. Oh, maybe there's an issue with that. We'll see about that. Okay. Fuck. Yeah. Can I do that? Let's try this. Yeah, so something is messed up here. So this, I have no idea what how to call that. Can I do that? Looks like I can. Okay. So, let's dig inside that. So what is a boost function? All right, so template. I'm supposed to declare my function like a boost function, I guess. Yeah. Whoa. Yeah. So I have to find a way to actually call some kind of generic boost function and pass a parameter. Okay, so what it is doing here is a do callback call, yeah. What's my func? My func. Okay, so it calls that. And that is a cast. Yeah. Okay, your callback equals. I'm not familiar with that syntax at all. Yeah, so he's asking how to pass a parameter to the function. So do callback is this one. And type def function, boost function. Okay, so it is setting a type there for void int code, which is this. Okay. Let's try it. So what if I do that? Whatever. I don't want this. I want like this. And here. Use a void expression. Oops. Yeah, something doesn't seem logic here, which is, I'm not sure how to call that. So why would it your equals TL? Back. Wow. Can I do that? So I'm supposed to declare it this way. Okay. Wow. Thank you, Boost. Very clean. Not sure if I can do that. Let's see. No, not there. Supposed to be there. And I lost my copy paste, obviously. Will it build? Yes, it will. Now I guess I can do that. I'm not sure why they were using this syntax and why it was working. Honestly, I'm not sure I understand that. Okay. So this is cool because, okay, so why define locally but not use? Oh yeah. No return statement. In a function returning non-void. Yeah. What am I supposed to return there? This is... I mean... Yeah. What is the return value for that? Boost function void return value. Returns void and takes a string. Can I do something like that? This is, I mean, okay, hold on. Am I obliged to call it this way? Yes, I am. Yeah. Okay. At least it removes the warning. Yeah, now I have two of them. No return statement and... okay. I think that's the proper way to do it, but I'm not sure. So, I never used the boost framework before, and this might seem like a very huge deal because it's a very common and popular framework. When I had the choice between one and the other, I started using Qt, and Qt has a way better syntax, so I believe, has a better syntax for my needs. Now the boost library might be a little lower level, so with better performance and all, but I'm not a big fan of that kind of syntax here. Actually, the Qt library bypasses most of the ugliness in terms of syntax by pre-processing with QMake, you know, using like the QObject instruction there tells QMake to put a bunch of, you know, dirty things inside of the class that we don't want to see when we're reviewing the code. And I find it to be a very wise way to do things because you can keep the code clean. Maybe at one point I'll end up, you know, type defing this, which is what they did, by the way. I could use a type dev there. Actually, maybe we should use one. Let's close that. Whoops. I could type dev boost function, boost void or something like that, but yeah. Why would I do that though? No, I'll keep it this way for now. So now there should be a way for us to see something here. So let me clean motion box. Actually, let me do that. And let me run it. All right. Okay. That's great. So yeah, I was triggered there. You can see the A was triggered. So let me quit that. So what we need to do now, and hopefully we can progress faster now, what we need to do now, and it's been like more than an hour that I streamed that, you know, what we need to do now is read this. So we need to pop alerts. Now this should be more straightforward. Why? Wait, but why?
Seriously? The LibTorrent is not using that? This is, come on. Alright. It's in Python though, there. Okay, there. So, let me see that. Okay, it's a vector. Pop alerts, yeah, it's a vector. STD vector. Okay. Nothing too tedious there. So we should be able to do something like that. Well, actually, yeah, that should work. So if we do that, there should be a way to, whoops. No. Oh, sorry about that. Well, actually, yeah, I'm going to pop the vector instead of just one by one, because I believe they said it was faster. So we should do that. Something like that. So here, syntax is not good. Oops. No. I'm not sure why. Hold on. Yeah. Okay. There we go. So, hopefully my struggle at the beginning of this stream will make you confident that even if you're just a beginner, you know, in a way or in another, when we're programming, we're beginners every day. That doesn't mean that it's a bad thing. You're always beginning. You're always a new beginner in something, in a new technology. When you're a programmer, you're going to use so much things that ultimately you're going to learn every day. And so I believe that what matters when it comes to coding is not being an expert, not being a wise guy that has everything in store in his mind. It's not about being a savant, if you want, or a sage or whatever. Being a programmer is about being a learner, learning by practicing, by doing stuff. And so I believe that there are two things that are very important. The first thing is to do things. Just do it. Even if, you know, if you want to, I don't know, build a game, start by drawing a rectangle. And even if it takes like one day, one entire day of, you know, displaying the rectangle, you have to persist. And that's the second perk. That's the second skill that you need as a developer. You need to be persistent. You need to persist. You need to persevere into what you're doing, because the combination of being eager to learn, not being afraid to fail, or not being afraid to look bad or anything like that, and being persistent is what will make you succeed. Let me, for a second here, tell you a very quick story. When I was studying in Epitech, I remember we were doing a game. So on the second year, we were supposed to build a game with OpenGL and stuff like that. And we had a first course, and we were supposed to display some kind of shape using SDL, I believe, at this time. And I remember that day very well, because everybody was successfully displaying the circle or the square, I'm not sure about that, and I wasn't. And I struggled and struggled and struggled, and at one point everyone had left and they had, you know, successfully displayed their square, and I didn't. And I stayed until it was until I did, and until it was working perfectly. And the next thing I did, which was the next month, I built actually the premises, the basic implementation of what is GL Zelda there. And so I went from struggling to display a square to actually delivering on an OpenGL, you know, parallaxed version of Zelda in OpenGL, if you will. And so I went from struggling displaying a square to having that kind of program, you know, just displaying an entire world with day-night conditions, with monsters, with interaction, and with everything. And it all started with me struggling displaying a square. So if you struggle,
you know, it's a good sign that you're persisting. Because when you're struggling, you're also persisting. So if you persist, at one point you'll be able to do great things. So never give up. If you love something, do it until it works. You know, and then ultimately, you know, we presented that game, which was honestly one of the best program I've ever written. It's not very complex, but I think it really captures the Zelda spirit, even though it's not very interactive, but it has a fully fledged custom editor that I'm, you know, showcasing there. And so every monster had a script and there was interaction and you could zoom in and zoom out, things that would never be possible in the 16-bit era, where that Zelda comes from, where the sprites from this Zelda come from. And so I was very happy to succeed in going that far into re-implementing my own VR Zelda. Now, when I was at school, I liked to focus on what I was doing. I focused a lot on lots of stuff, on projects that I love. And so sometimes I wouldn't do a project because I wanted to focus on another one. And it was a very bad move when it comes to, you know, having good grades and, you know, being successful as a student, if you will, in terms of the grades and everything. But I did not really care about that. I knew that what I was supposed to do is to learn as much as possible in the fields I was interested in. Learn to learn, pretty much. So that when I'm out of the school, you know, these things that I would have learned would stay with me. And so I focused on many projects, but the ray tracing project, this project, and a few others. And you know, the other one that I did not focus on ultimately at one point, if I had to learn the related technology, I did. But I like to go further and to persist more and to go all the way towards completing something, which is here. It's a demo homage slash tribute to Zelda. But I like to go all the way until I deliver something. I'm not satisfied by just having some kind of testing work. I want to go all the way. So, you know, I'm struggling to express myself here, but, you know, hopefully you'll get the idea, not just by my words, but by the way I try to express it. So let's close that and let's go back to the code, because that's what we're here for. So here I'm popping the alerts and I get back a vector. So what we need to do next is do that, most likely. Yeah, print alerts. So we need an iterator. So I'm not a big fan of declaring iterator this way, actually. Whoops. Sorry about that. So I'm not sure if I need iterators at all the points in the code, I believe so. Yeah, there. Not sure why I'm using that though. Oh yeah, I'm using that because I had to. Not big fan of this syntax here. So okay, so here is the beginning. We need to do a while there. While we're at the end. While, hold on. Nah. Okay. Yeah. Sucks. Okay, so why? Oops. Plus YY, yeah. Nah. Just do it this way, man. Come on. So this is incrementing, it's supposed to be faster than doing this, so I believe. But I, you know, I think that's the kind of optimization that messes up the code And so you end up with something that's not very readable, so... You know. Okay, so this obviously does not work because it's not the proper type. So that's one of the issues we have. Because... Yeah. Go on this one. Nope. So this should be a type of libtorrent. I hope it is though. Yeah, it is. So yeah, I believe that as a programmer, the most important skill is to persevere. Doesn't matter to be a Jedi or a ninja or whatever. It's cool and all because, you know, people are going to get impressed by how fast you implement something. But implementing something fast is nothing. What matters is how can you iterate. And at one point, you know, success is just a series of unimpressive, you know, small victories that, by the way, needed to be persisted over and again and again. So persisted over again and again. So, yeah. Just code it and persist. That is the reason why also it's very important to be passionate when it comes to coding, because if you're not passionate at one point, you need to persist so much that, you know, it just gets... It can get to you. If you're not passionate about it, it's very difficult to move on. Because sometimes, you know, because sometimes nothing works. So you have to change your perspective, you know, in real life, at school, or, you know, the way we see things in real life, if you will, is very different than the way you have to see them when you're a coder. Because, you know, a computer is very different than I don't know, building furniture or anything like that. It's very different. It's a very different job, really. It's a very different kind of work. So I believe that a programmer has to be unimpressed of failing, because failure is crucial if he wants to succeed. You need to be unimpressed of failing. I believe that, you know, in lots of jobs these days, lots of jobs, I mean, if you're a lawyer, if you're human resource, if you're a banker or anything, failure is extremely bad and you want to avoid that at all cost, and you're scared to death of failing. You hate failure. As a programmer, I'm glad to say I love it, because every time I fail, I learn. And so failure is not an option where you're a programmer. It's a necessity. You have to fail. If you're not prepared to fail, if you're not prepared to let go of your ego and accept failure, you're not going to be a great programmer, because you're going to give up, because it gives you too much failure for too few successes. So you have to accept that success is all about failure. And I believe this is also true in real life. It's only that we have a culture, especially in France, maybe, I'm not sure about that, where failure is always something bad, and it says wrong things about your person, about the person you are. Screw that. Forget about this. Failure is the way to success when it comes to coding. So accept to fail, persist, and you'll do great things, even if you're not the most talented mathematician or whatever when it comes to algorithm stuff. So type def const element, define not user. Okay, still the same warning. So here we get that, and I'm not sure how I'm supposed to print the alert. Timestamp. Okay, so he's casting that. Okay, easy. So as you can see, I'm copy-pasting a lot. You have to be unashamed of doing so. It's not a problem to copy-paste, as long as you're understanding what you're doing. You know. That's the timestamp. Yeah, he's doing it this way. We don't care about that. Let's see here. Maybe I can do that directly. So, yeah. Oops. Oops. Libtorrent alert. I'm gonna use the pointer and we want to see the message. Should be able to do that. And the message is most likely a string, so yeah. That okay. Yeah. So yeah, I'm supposed to pop alerts every time there's one. Let me print another one here to be sure that we go through the loop. There we go. Woohoo! We got something displayed here. So, yeah. Also, something I would like to mention. You know, looks like today I'm really interested about talking about failure. Sometimes you're failing at something and you've been doing it for a week and it does not work and you fail to do something extremely simple. And you hate it because you feel that there's no progress or whatever. But sometimes you succeed in doing it and it wasn't obvious at all because nothing ever is. And sometimes the simplest things are the less obvious ones. Sometimes also you have to take another way, but that's another story. Anyway, you succeed in that. And then all of a sudden you add a few bunch of other lines. We struggle, for instance, here we struggle for an hour. Figuring out how to use the boost function, function pointer. Then we figured this out and now we're displaying stuff. And so we went from figuring out a very simple problem to make the program build all the way to printing very concrete messages there. And we did that in less of a time than figuring out something elementary. So when it comes to coding, time is distorted sometimes. You do something extremely simple in a very long period of time and something very complex or that you would assume would be complex in a very short span of time. So you also have to be, I would say, humble about time and accept that you're not controlling it. And so that's one of the reasons why it's so hard to respect deadlines when it comes to programming, because you never know what's around the corner, but you have to accept that you don't control time, so you can do your best guess or your best bet, or when you've already done something, you can estimate. If you're doing something you've never done before, I believe you cannot estimate the time it will take. You couldn't do that. You cannot. You can use the rule of the three, which I like to call, which is you multiply by three what you think it is going to take mentally. You think, you know, one day for that, okay, it's 3 days, 1 week, 3 weeks. What you've already done, obviously, you know, and that's the reason why we tend to industrialize, you know, programming, because when you industrialize something, you can replicate a process that you thought of before. The problem with that is that when you do that too much, it has an impact on creativity. So being creative in programming is also, in most cases, not knowing when you will be done. And that's the reason why lots of successful gaming company, for instance, are the one that delayed their games a lot. I'm thinking about Valve, about Blizzard, about these guys, because they care about being creative as opposed of delivering an industrial product. So here we're going to do something like that. I think it's going to be cleaner if we do it this way. And we'll move on. Okay. Hmm, for some reason. Yeah. Generated PID and empty. Okay. So, I guess we can assume that libtorrent is running fine. So now we can assume that we can call it, which is exciting times. So let me try, actually, let me try to stream something. So yeah, if I go there, okay, let's try it up. What if I go there and is there a torrent there? Yep. Okay. And I drag and drop that. Okay. As you can see, inside of the torrent, we have a Tears of Steel WebM file. So the question I have is, what happens if I play it? Okay. So loading Tears of Steel WebM failed. Okay. So here, there's an issue. And there's an issue with my backend. Torrent, most likely. If you look at my backend torrent there, you can see that I haven't set the source for the track. Or did I? Yeah, I set the path. We don't want the path to be set. We want the source to be set. So what I want is, hold on. Yeah, I probably need that. Let's quit that. I probably need a query there, and I need to do something like query URL. So the URL there is the torrent URL. So I probably need to do something like that. In the future, what I want to do is, let me explain to you very quickly the way I'm going to construct torrent so that we can access files inside of it right away. It's going to be very simple. If we take this one, for instance, you know, you can see that there's a URL like that, right? And if I run MotionBox again, we can see the name of the file. Well, actually, forget about this. Let's say that there is so that's the name of the torrent there. Okay. What I want to do there is I want to keep that, which is the URL, and I want to do this and then video file dot mp4 or dot webm in that case. And so what you, when you will give a URL like this to MotionBox, because MotionBox is URL driven, that's something very important. MotionBox is a GUI, but there's an engine inside of it that pretty much processes URL. So when you give me a torrent like this with, you know, a video file like that, MotionBox will be able to go right away to the video file and play it. So that's the source that will be embedded in the video track that I'm extracted here. But anyway, long story short, what I'm supposed to do there is most likely this. Will it build? No, it won't. Because you cannot do it this way. You have to do it this way. You can do it this way. All right, so now, there should be something different displayed in the console when we try to play the track. Let's see about that. So if I play that, actually, let me reload that. Yeah. If I do play now, yeah. As you can see, what happens there, that's very cool, is, you know, he's trying to get that. So it's trying to load the source, and to get that. And obviously, it's not supported by any backend. And that's normal. It's not supported by any backend. So, okay, I know what happens. So what happens is that it goes through, yeah. Okay. Let me explain. That's cool. I believe we can make it work pretty fast. So, I'm going to try to stop saying all the time because there's no point. Yeah, here. See, say it again. What's the function here? Track source. I'm not in the proper one. Not supported by a backend. Is it something problematic? I don't think so. So. Yeah, since it has the extension, the torrent extension is going to try to load it. So that's not good. That's not good. There's a way for us to overcome that. But I'm not a big fan of it, though. Yeah, I think that what we're going to have to do is very simple indeed. We need to do something like that. Currently, the issue we have, and there's no sound. The issue we have there is the fact that, yeah, we need torrent there. We need torrent there. That should be working. Yeah, and it's trying to extract the source again. Not normal. Normal. You shouldn't be doing that. Yeah, I think I know why. Is it loaded by default? Yeah, it's loaded by default. So the source is there. Why would you call that? Hold on. I'm not sure why he's loading the source. Yeah, because he's most likely because he's written a check valid URL there. Okay. Let's try something. Get URL track. It's not the one I want.
So let's focus here. What happens when I click on that is I'm clicking on this, and he's most likely going to extract the source. So this should be happening in the controller media, if I'm correct about that. What's happening there is I pretty much say, okay, get media, man. Is it what really happens though? We'll see. So get media is task in one thing, is supposed to retrieve the proper media file. Yeah, that's what happened there. Okay, so he's going to get that, but for some reason, and that's the issue we have there, when we do that there, hold on, load source, here, he's going to do that. So he's deciding to call the controller media with that, and that's not normal. You shouldn't do that. So let's see about that. Backend VLC. Not backend VLC, backend net. Let's start from the player. Always good to start from the beginning. So here I'm setting the source, okay? Oops. So it's going to load the source. Cool. It's going to load the source from the backend, if backend. Backend source equal URL. So the backend is backend VLC. Fair enough. So it's going to load the source. Going to do backend set source. And where does it actually decide all the thing? I'm confused right now. Yeah. Do I go there? Hey. No, I don't. So there's an issue there. I don't go there. Why don't I go there? Why don't I go there? Not sure about that. Minus one there. I don't get it. I don't remember how this works. That's the problem. Okay. It happens. So why, where am I going to call? Okay, so it's okay. Let's relax. I'm supposed to call this somewhere. I guess I'm calling this somewhere. Yeah, okay, here it is. Woo! I'm calling a get media here. Do I actually print something? Yeah, loading source, okay. Yeah. So there's something that I don't understand. Okay. Could be loaded right away. So here there's gonna be something happening. Update source. Okay. So get media. New media reply. Okay. Update source. Okay, updating the source. Source contains URL. Yeah. then we're cached, otherwise load source. Okay. Now. Yeah, there it is. Yeah. So backend from URL there. That's not what we want. That's not the proper way to do it. Or is it? Hold on. We're getting the get query source here. Yeah. And here it's not supported by backend. Okay, but this could happen. I mean, yeah, this could happen. So what we need to do is actually, okay. Backend torrent is supposed to return a source. Yeah, and as you can see here, what I'm doing is when we, yeah, okay. Huh. Yeah. So here the source can be null. And if the source is null, then we try to play it with VLC anyway. Yep. So, yeah. Here. Get query source, you know, it should construct a default backend net query. So this should be empty. Is valid equals false. So if this is false, then OK bye. Okie dokie. Yeah. So get query source there as a result should not, by default it's returning the URL by default. That's bad. Yeah, okay, I know what to do then. Am I re-implementing this elsewhere? Yeah, all right. So what we need to do is fairly simple. We need to do this. Because by default, he is returning the same URL. Easy. Yeah. Is returning the same URL. Here we have to find a way for the backend to say, you know what? Even though it's a valid URL, the source itself is not valid. That means that I cannot extract that source. You have to deal it yourself. Deal with it yourself. So we're going to do it this way, but maybe I'll refactor it though, because maybe the default behavior that I want with the get query source is the one I'm going to implement in backend torrent. So never mind. Yeah, that's pretty much a hack right now. You know, a hack will do, but maybe I want to do that differently. So what happens there is, I don't need that. What should happen there is the backend torrent will say, you know what? I cannot play that file. I cannot extract the source, any source from that file. You have to deal it yourself. You have to deal it on the player side. The player will be able to play it fine. You know, just, we don't need to extract anything from this. And then what should happen is the player should try to play it.
which is what happens there, as you can see. We're good to go, guys. Awesome. Okay, so now the fun part. In the hook, in the torrent hook, actually. Oh, actually, I'm not sure I have implemented my torrent hook. Hook torrent. I think I've just created the file and I'm not sure it's ready to roll, actually. So now we're going to have to implement the hook. And I'm not sure about how to do that. Once again. So how is it going to work? How is the hook going to work? It's probably going to work on the player level of things. I don't see myself implementing it at a lower level. So what needs to be done there is most likely a list of hooks in the declarative player. And you know, you can set a list of hooks, if you will. I think it should be a good idea to do that. I could do a function, or I could do a list there. I don't know. Or I could do just a simple hook. You know what? Since I only have one hook right now, I'm not going to do the complex implementation. I'm going to keep it simple because right now I want to keep it simple. So this is the way I'm going to do it, to implement it. Going to be like that. I'm not sure if I can couple these two right there, but yeah, there we go. So here it's going to be an abstract backend hook. Abstract hook, does it exist? It does. So here, hook. Here it should be working now. So, yeah. You know what? Yeah. Yeah. Okay, we're going to see how it goes. Bunch of things that I might consider. I'd have to consider that. So the way the hook is going to work is fairly simple. I'll let you see that in a minute. Whoa. Why parent item this? Weird. Not sure about that though. Yeah. So if a hook already exists. Yeah. Delete backend, what does this do? Yeah, remain.
I did not remember implementing that, but it could be useful somewhere. Do I need to do that? Probably. I don't. Why? Why don't I need to do that? This is weird. Narrative player. Try to rebuild it. I'd like to do that on stream, but you know, I want to make sure that I didn't screw anything. Okay. For some reason, I don't need to forward declare the abstract backend. I'm not sure why, because it's there. There's got to be a good reason for that. Maybe because it's already defined here. Well, in that case, I'm not sure why I'm supposed to declare abstract hook. Yeah, that's a little bit of a mystery. It's probably going to be forward declared in another class I'm implementing there. Maybe in an abstract playlist, for instance. Nope. Maybe in abstract track? Yeah, I'm not sure about that. Never mind. Okay, so let's proceed. Here, as you can see, I can now set a hook, and so this hook is most likely going to be deleted when I change it. And so in order for that to work, I need to make sure that we can do it on the QML side of things. And I believe that I did that for backend VLC before. Did I? Controller media. Yeah, it is. Okay, so I'm registering the type here. Okay. Make sure it works. Okay, so I probably need to do the same in controller torrent. Oops. Controller torrent. New VLC engine. Let's do it there. So there I'm going to do hook torrent. Is going to be our hook. Let's see how this works. So here I'm adding the declarative module because I need it if I want to declare anything related to GUI. So now I need to run qmake on this again and probably need to rebuild it. Yeah, cool. The hook torrent is now not declared. It's not declared here. That's normal. All right. No such file or directory. What the F? Shouldn't be this way. Okay. Never mind, we're going to regenerate includes again. Where is this? Okay, there. Okay, it's not Omega, it's Sky. Include. So this small script here is generating every include that we need. So it should be working better. No matching function to call hook torrent default. Yes. That's normal, actually. Yeah, it's not a good way to do it. Or at the very least, we should do it. Yeah. Nah. It's not the good way if we want to declare it from QML, so we should do it this way. Actually, let me check. So he's not happy here because when he's creating the object from QML, obviously there is no default parameter. You know, it's going to be empty. And so I didn't specify any constructor to do so, so he's not very happy about it. Now, I thought originally that I needed to do one, but I don't think I do. So I'm most likely going to do something like that. Where's the abstract backend there? Yeah, it's there. So yeah, I'm going to do something like that. Now we need to fix it. So we don't need backend there. Can just remove that and that. Right here. Whoops. Nah, don't go there. Here. Nope. Backend by default is going to be null. Cool. I'm not happy. That. Cool. There it works. Okay, so now we're going to be able to do something cool, which is go there. We have a backend. Cool. Now we can have a hook. Woohoo! Awesome. So this should work. Yep. This should work, and now we should have a hook. Do we? Let's try it out. Yep. Be good. Is it? Okay. Type wall video. Backend torrent is not a type. Yes, it's a type, man. Do you declare the... Do I declare the controller there? Yes, I do. So, if I create it... yeah. It's there. I keep clicking on the wrong tab here. So... Backend torrent is not a type. Yes, it is. Whoops. No, it's not. It's not a backend, man. Come on. It's a hook. It's a freaking hook. So this component right there, the hook, is what's going to enable us to play torrents. So, you know, without it, we're just using a generic VLC player. But with the hook, we're going to be able to call libtorrent and say, you know what, start downloading it, and when enough data is there, we just play the file. So that's pretty cool. That's pretty exciting stuff. So now I need to find a way for the hook to be called. So
for that to happen, what needs to happen first is in the set, in the hook, we need to find a way, we need to have a way, sorry, in an abstract hook there, we need to have a way to set a backend. We need that. So I'll explain that in a minute, but a hook needs a backend. Without the backend, the hook is useless. So we're going to need a backend inside of the hook so that it knows which backend to call when enough data is available. So I'm going to declare signals here. Yep. And properties. There we go. And private stuff there. Okay. So here. Why wouldn't you go there? Okay. Here we need to get there. And here we need to go properties. So we're going to specify a property which is going to be the backend. The backend to be called by the hook when enough data is processed, if you will. It's going to be there. You know, man, I would really love to be able to play that. I would really love to be able to play something before ending that stream today, but it's going to be hard. We'll see. We'll see what we can do. All right, so now I need that. Is it the same one? Yes, no. So it's not going to be parented in any way. So it's just going to be, you know, if my backend equals your backend, then I return. If not, I set it. Whoa. Yeah, and then I'm just emitting the backend has changed, folks. There we go. Cool. So now I need to do something there. Yeah. I'm calling these properties and not variables though. Is that so? Yeah, not properties, guys. Variables. Anyway. Yeah. No. Not good, guys. We need to fix that. So, that kind of issue, of syntactic issue, I try to fix them every time I encounter them. So obviously, you know, not a very big deal, but I want to keep it consistent if I have to iterate on it. So here, as you can see, there's all the issue there. It's not properties, it's variables. Variables there. Them. Oops. No. Active player, variables. No. Well, actually, it could also be called property. I'm not sure about that. Yeah. Forget about it. I'll deal with it later. I'm not sure about how I want to call these. It's a detail, but you know. Let's keep it this way for now. Okay, cool. I watch. Yeah. Okay. So here. Sorry about that. Here I'm going to init that to null. So I did a case. I did a case, so it's okay. No problem. Let's try to build that. So now, if we run it, Okay, cannot assign object to property. Why? Drag hook. That hook. Yeah. Drag hook. Hook changed. Torrent. Oh. Do I need to register the type somewhere, maybe? Yes, I need. Yeah. Right. Shoot. Okay, so I need to register that. Where is the abstract hook indeed? Yeah, it's in GUI. Let's do it. And let's be on. So I tried to put the abstract include on top of it, on top of other includes. Make sure that it's very clear when I read the code. Yeah. Okay, so now it works. And now the object should be a valid one. There you go. So now the hook is set and the motion box is happy about it. No problem about it. He is very happy about it. So now, on the declarative side of on the declarative player, here I'm setting a hook. Actually, I could do that. Am I doing that some places? Yeah. Yeah. It's okay. Now I'm supposed to do that. Set backend. Backend. That way I have a backend, no problem about that. A matching function to call set backend. Why? Oh. There you have it. So now, most likely, the backend should be set. Now there is a... this is where we come in. So, here's the thing. When we set the source in the declarative player here, something's going to happen. Something is going to happen. we're going to check whether the source has to be hooked or not. We're going to check whether the hook wants to handle it or not. If it wants to handle it, then we're going then we're most likely going to hook it this way, and so we're going to replace the backend there by the hook. So if I'm not mistaken, since an abstract hook is also an abstract backend, we're going to be able to have a pointer inside of declarative player that will be a generic backend that we call, and the player will not know whether it's a hook or not. The cool thing about it though is that we only need to do one if on the load source here. And once we did that if, we know we're going to decide here which backend to use. So there'll be no friction. I mean, if it's an MP4 and if it's a video file, no problem. Just keep the default backend. If it's a torrent, then go to the hook. and do everything we need in the hook. So there'll be just one if, you know, deciding which one we'll use. So it will be frictionless, and it will keep the performance, and it will be transparent for the most part. Yeah, that's what we'll do, and we'll do it next time, because now it's already 11:32, and I actually need to stop it. But before doing so, we're going to write history about what we did today. So to help me do that, what I can do is do a diff here, and yeah, regenerated includes, so there's a bunch of information there. Actually, hold on a sec. Let me check something. Do we really need to do that? I don't think we need to do that. Actually, did we do anything else than this? No, we didn't. No, because I think that what happens is that I back away to the player anyway. But we have to make sure of that. Let's try it again. So I'm doing that. I'm doing that. I'm playing play. And yeah, it tries to play on VLC. And obviously VLC says, cannot play that, man. The torrent. VLC is unhappy about it. But yeah, we don't need that. So again, let's diff it. So yeah, it includes. So first in declarative player, we did a bunch of things. Yeah, we added the hook property. Okay. In the abstract backend, we added the backend property. The controller media, what did we do? Yeah. We fixed. Okay, SK torrent, we've added network, obviously, controller torrent. Whoops. In controller torrent, I did added a bunch of things. That backend torrent. So I'm doing this on stream because I want to be transparent about everything I do, and you know, I'm going to try to separate these commits, do a bunch of, you know, specific commits, committing every file I need at every time, because I don't want to commit this as a whole bunch of things. But I don't like to commit too much on stream because I think it takes a long time, and so. So backend torrent, fixed track source handling, something like that. Backend torrent, hook torrent.
And lastly, Toa and Tenjin, we changed a bunch of things today, but most of it was figuring out how to use boost function, but now I know how to use them, so it's cool. You're just supposed to declare them, just like you would declare any function. And so here in the torrent engine we did added process alert, alert process function, process alert function, whoops, which is cool to know what happens. And lastly, in the whole video, so obviously everything is in SkyKit there, but this one is going to be in MotionBox. In the wall video, added torrent hook to player. There you have it. Okay, so I guess that will wrap this up for this time, guys. Once again, quick reminder that the entire source code of MotionBox is available online. You can download MotionBox anytime you want from here, and it has a self-updating module inside of it. So you can, every time there's a new version, you just have to click one button and you get the new version. You can support it, you can get the sources of MotionBox and SkyKit. And if you have any question, I know that this project needs to be spread a little bit, and right now there's not much activity on the forum, but if you have any question, don't hesitate to post them either in the chapter discussion, or if you're more of a random viewer, if you will, and don't really care about seeing how the program is done, then you can just, you know, just ask a question on the highlight page. I'll answer both anyway, but you know, it's up to you. And you'll get everything that I did today available on the website as soon as I've uploaded it. So thank you for watching. Thank you for being here today. And take very good care of you. Don't forget to relax and everything. And in the next stream, we'll probably have a video running from a torrent. So it's exciting times. I hope I can do a stream next week. Maybe I'll continue implementing a few things during this week, at the end of this week. So you can check the GitHub for that. And I believe no one has any questions. So thank you very much and take good care of you.